Hello and welcome to another episode of World Beyond Belief. In our ongoing effort to wake people up to the reality that is behind the matrix control system, we've been trying to expose many, many frauds. And actually on our blog, we even have a thing called Ununiversity to help you unlearn a lot of the things that you've been force-fed and the media has been feeding to you down through the years. Well, I thought that AIDS was an invented reality that was invented by the military-industrial complex to target certain groups. And come to find out that it's a lot more than that. A lovely lady came into our lives called Elizabeth Eli, and she's been working on this topic totally, exclusively for years. And what she's found out, that AIDS is a lot more of a deception than that. So we're going to talk to Elizabeth, Beth Eli, for a while, see what she has to say about this strange disease that seemed to inflict us, I don't know, 40 years ago. So let me welcome to the World Beyond Belief, Elizabeth Eli. Why don't you say hi and tell us a little bit about your background and how you got into this?
Okay, well, I'll start by saying that it's pronounced Ely, but I do that Ely a million times a day.
Okay.
But thanks for calling me Beth. Yes, I am Beth. And what did you want to know? You wanted to know how I got into this?
How you got in? Well, first of all, a little bit about you, and then how you got into this funny position of being a truth teller.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. It just kind of found me. And as you can see, this is on video. I am a white middle-class female who is not part of the risk groups for this particular nightmare, which sort of gives me an advantage of sitting outside it and not being consumed by it. Although I think that it was very much a part of my my education as an American liberal was an article of faith, is that human rights concerns, which I was very much concerned with, include being concerned about people who have a dread disease and about how, at the time, the story was the government just doesn't care. These are marginalized groups. We must weep for marginalized groups. Of course we should. But I was in my 20s, and I had a degree in music from a Midwestern university, and I decided to go back to school. I was living in Dallas, Texas at the time, which is not where I'm from. I'm from Michigan. And I decided to go back to school for journalism, and I was very idealistic. I was 27 years old. I went 2 years to journalism school, master's degree from NYU, New York University. I landed in New York. Of course, it was everything that I had read about. It was, you know, all these people living on the streets. It was all these problems that I could engage with. I was, in a sense, naive, but in a sense, like, really willing to learn. And I graduated basically without a job, and I was temping, and a friend handed me a book that related directly to the temping work I was doing, which was actually at the Hemophilia Foundation. I was just a clerical worker there, working for the executive director. My desk was right outside his office. I don't recall his name. And I was told, you know, here, read this book, and this will bounce you out of the HIV hoax that you're believing. And actually, you know, the Hemophilia Foundation is and was an AIDS organization from that point. You know, this was 1992. And I thought I would make short work of this in about a week, and it made short work of me, because there's something about basic logic and facts that neither side refutes that just adds up to a real story. So when you say you're going to call this the myth of AIDS, correct?
I think something like that, yeah.
Okay, well, that's really apt, because what I've found is more mythology than fact. And I mean real mythology, like all the themes of mythology in this. I often liken AIDS to a hurricane. you know, if you've seen those pictures of the hurricane and it's all swirling around the eye of the storm, the eye of the storm, there's just basically nothing there. There's no virus, there's no, you know, we can go into all that, but there's basically nothing there. And around it is all this mythological stuff, which really pushes buttons in human beings. Things about sex, things about contamination, things about blood contamination, all kinds of things. But I hope my answer hasn't been too long. I mean, I think you asked me, you know, how I got involved in this. And really how I think the more interesting question is, why am I still in it 23 years later? Like, you know, it should be boring by now. And to be honest, it's getting boring on a certain level. But the mythology has never failed to fascinate me.
How people have left this thing alone. Nobody has gotten into this, really investigating the core of this. Now, both of us know that John Rappaport has done a lot of research and done a lot of writing on this.
But yeah, we interviewed John Rappaport. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I should mention that I do have a podcast called How Positive Are You, if we're getting into my background. And I run that podcast with a co-host, David Crow, who is president of Rethinking AIDS. And it's not true that people haven't investigated this. Many people have investigated this. There's a petition online with, I think, over 3,000 people on it. And I think just to sign the petition, you have to be a scientist or a journalist or something. I qualified because I'm a journalist. So these are people who have actually given this some thought. It's not true that nobody looks into it. What is true is that you're not only not going to hear it on the media, you're not going to hear it in here. Like, it just doesn't land.
Well, let me play devil's advocate for a minute and go back
Please
to,
do.
Let me try to think of a mindset that I was in a long time ago. And they'll say, well, how can you consider this not to be a major disease and a major threat when we found all these people coming down with AIDS and it seems to be so prevalent and it seems to come from sex? What? How did the tell me about the mythology that got us into that mindset.
Okay. So when you're talking to me about that, you're being the devil's advocate.
Yeah, that's
you're
what I wanted.
Being the average person who's never heard of this. I hear two things, okay? One, I hear, you know, well, we all know the facts. We hear them on the news. Duh. There's a virus. It's eating people's immune systems. But that's the smaller part. That's the little part in the middle of the hurricane. The part around it that's swirling by at like 180 miles an hour is what I also heard in that. Like, how can you say this doesn't exist? This is, you know, my friends have died. You don't care about those people in Africa. You're a denialist, okay? You're
right.
In denial because there is this huge thing happening in the world. And so my response is that definitely there is a huge thing happening in the world. I wouldn't be involved in something on a nothing happening in the world. The problem is that the explanation that's given for these various phenomena around the world is not adequate, okay? So I hope that answers your question. I mean, we could go further into it.
Yeah, let's say I have a cousin who has AIDS.
Yeah, emotional response. I have a cousin who has AIDS.
Right.
I have a friend who has cancer. How can, you know, like, this is real for you. This is fair, and there's no reason why it shouldn't be real. Okay, go on.
Well, what do they have then, Beth? I mean, what's wrong with them? How have we been tricked into seeing a disease when there's no disease there?
Yeah. You ask me what your cousin has, I have to tell you, I don't know your cousin, and I don't know what he has. Okay?
Right.
I tell people, I don't know these people, let alone autopsy them, okay? So there are many reasons why people die in this world and many reasons why they will die of a particular cluster of symptoms that a particular cluster of people have. The problem with AIDS is that it's such a broad umbrella. It's a layer of meaning put on top of diseases that already exist and already existed for millennia or some of them are pretty new actually, that it's almost, you can call almost anything AIDS. Now there's a list of 26 to 29 things down at the CDC that are called AIDS related conditions. But really, for emotional purposes, anyone who has tested positive on a particular test, whether they have a broken ankle or pneumonia, they're considered to have AIDS. And this is a real absurdity. So what happens is your cousin who tested positive on a test elicited an emotional reaction in himself and others that could indeed wreck his health. And I think that's a grave injustice, because as I'll explain, these tests are not worth anything. They are really not worth a darn thing, not even worth getting, for what they find at almost 100% accuracy, which it's insignificant. But what happens is it puts that layer of meaning on top of it, this umbrella. So whatever happens to your cousin from that point on becomes AIDS-related, and it becomes a subject of intense fear that it's not just a cold, it's not just the flu, it's not just a yeast infection of some sort. It's AIDS, and AIDS is going to kill you. And then there's this other story that, no, it's not going to kill you because we have better drugs today. It's all a construct. It doesn't need to happen.
Well, that's so cool. We spent, on Monday, we had an interview with Dr. Eric Carlson, and he was talking about Tavistock. Tavistock is an institute in London that's been kind of running our lives, all of our lives. They created the hippie movement, created the New Age movement, created all those things. And now it studies traumatology. And there's probably nothing more traumatology, how people react to trauma. Matter of fact,
being told you've got a dread disease and you're going to die is pretty traumatic. I've been told that myself, not related to HIV, but related to cancer. And I can tell you that happened 11 years ago, and I'm fine today. But just getting out of that, out of that state of trauma was the biggest step.
So you go in and you're diagnosed. Well, I have a stupid question.
Yeah.
You'll probably be diagnosed with HIV first, and then HIV turns into AIDS. How does that work? You probably know a lot about you're diagnosed with HIV.
Yeah. The story is that you test HIV positive, and that means you have this infection.
Okay.
Sorry for the scare quotes, but anyway, and that whatever you get from that point forward is going to be AIDS related, because this infection is basically eating your immune system, as if your immune system were just a thing called T cells. Which is another story in itself. I mean, it's just layers and layers of stories, and they all reinforce each other, right? So it's a kind of hall of mirrors. So anything after that is interpreted as AIDS. And in fact, the people who get these diagnoses may in fact get diseases that don't match what you and I get as fairly healthy middle-aged people,
right?
Okay? We're lucky to be white middle class people in America. You should see some of the shanty towns in Africa where these people live. I mean, it's the height of naivete to think that they're even getting safe drinking water there. And you look at the populations of drug addicts or urban populations, basically poor people who are Black and Hispanic and have been discriminated against for eons. Those people are going to get certain diseases, especially people who turn to drugs to cope with that situation. There are certain things that happen to drug addicts. One of them is that they might get tuberculosis, which is kind of a 19th century disease. You know, like, I'm not at risk for tuberculosis. So you will see certain patterns, and you'll be tempted to draw certain conclusions from that. But it's so much more complex what people are getting sick of worldwide. And there may indeed be epidemics of certain things. There may be, for instance, epidemics of lung disease in miners in South Africa. But it gets the companies that they work for off the hook when it's declared that, oh, they're getting AIDS because they sleep with prostitutes.
Right.
You know, it's just an explanation that seems to serve whatever mindset the consumers of that information have.
Also, it's interesting with AIDS. There's a certain stigma or condemnation that comes with AIDS. So when you get that, everybody says, whoa, you must have been doing this or that or the other thing.
Oh God, that's a huge part of it. I think the one word that I want to retire from the English language is stigma. It's just been used as a manipulation that, and really a weapon against people like me who are asking intelligent questions, that somehow we don't understand the stigma, just how terrible it is to be picked on and to be told that your, you know, previously cool lifestyle is now this thing that landed you in hell. And that's a morality tale in itself, and I'm being accused of having a morality tale for not buying the explanation. You know, stigma. I think that these populations targeted, and they have admitted that they've targeted them for testing. I've done a podcast where somebody from the AIDS Healthcare Foundation admitted that they meet their quotas by targeting certain populations that are going to test positive. That these populations already have a stigma on them. That's why they were hauled in for testing. But also, yes, that is going to be traumatic when you hear that not only did you get a virus, but you got it by being bad. And bad being defined as you once had sex. I mean, you know, most of the human population has sex at some point in its you know, evolution and lifetime. It's only recently that you know, large millions of people are said to have sex and be getting something that's going to eat their immune systems. And the epidemiological data just don't support it being spread that way. So I'd like to kind of digress to one scientific matter, if I may.
Please. Please do.
Okay. You know, just to bring this conversation down to earth, into that little hole in the middle of the hurricane that I'm sure many listeners are probably sitting there going, yeah, but, you know, you haven't really told me there's nothing in the middle of that hurricane. There's only one fact that you really need to learn about this to see that there's nothing there. And that is that the tests don't find it. There are two kinds of commercially available HIV tests. They're called tests. There's also something you can do called an analysis, but we'll get into that later. But the first kind of test, the most common, and there are basically two types of those, there might be more, the ELISA and the Western blot, one confirms the other. Those are antibody tests. They find higher concentrations of antibodies in a person's blood than in the general population. And these are common antibodies, like we all have them, but people from tropical zones might have higher concentrations of them because they fought off more infections. The last I checked, antibodies were a good thing to carry around in your blood. And the more you have, the better, okay? Like, you're immune to things. I had chicken pox when I was a kid. I now have antibodies to chicken pox. I'm pretty good to go. People who haven't had chicken pox are at risk of getting it, and it's no picnic when you're an adult. You should have antibodies to stuff. That was the rationale behind vaccines the last time I checked, okay? Mm-hmm. You're actually being pumped in the arm with some antibodies, so that'll protect you, or some mild form of the virus that you will develop antibodies to, and then you'll be protected. The other test is called a viral load test, and that picks up random genetic material as far as I'm concerned. We could go in further into that, but neither one of them, this is a take home, neither one of them directly finds virus in your blood.
Oh.
Okay? It's not like they take it to a lab and they put your blood, uncontaminated, under an electron microscope and say, look at these things, these are particles resembling HIV. They don't do that. That would be horrendously expensive if they did to do that. So it's not a bad thing that we have substitute tests for pathogens or diseases that the original test would be too expensive for. The thing is, you have to test those new surrogate tests against actually finding virus. You have to have a population of people and you test, okay, these people tested positive under an electron microscope. That is, they are infected. Plus, they tested positive. And nobody else tests positive for that test. Does that make any sense? It's called validation. Validation doesn't mean your test is accurate. These tests that they're doing this are accurate. They're like 99.9 whatever accurate. But they find garbage. They don't find actual virus. So after you know that, everything else falls apart. You can't find, you know, large amounts of virus in people who have died on autopsy. You don't find it in people who are dying. They call this viral load. Oh, we're counting your viruses. That's just a name for something. That doesn't mean that's what that test does. And there's a new service coming out from a company called Viral Forensics. It's been widely ridiculed by the mainstream, which means you should check it out. Okay?
It does.
And they will actually, out of a lab in California, they will put your blood properly cultured so that it doesn't express things that would contaminate it. They put it under an electron microscope, and they compare it to a sample of known HIV. They look at the picture of the known HIV, they look at the picture of your blood, and they see if they look like each other. They see if you have those little things called HIV that the government is calling HIV, that researchers are calling HIV. In these samples they have, they're saying, do you have it? Okay? That's highly significant. And I'm guessing they're not finding it. Okay? That's the heads up on the research they've done so far. And they'll have this interpreted by a real licensed California pathologist. And he'll issue a report that says he sees no evidence that you have infection. Or if he does see it, of course he will, you know, the pictures are there. He'll tell the truth about that. And that will provide a service that people can supposedly, now we don't know, take to court. And prove that they didn't infect another person with HIV by having sex with them, take to court, and when their children are being taken away for not medicating them. This is very, very important. You will now have that test available. Now, you would think that the AIDS establishment would be cheering, saying, wow, we finally
right.
have a real HIV test. We don't have to deal with these surrogates. No, they're mortified. They're trying to squelch it. They're just using every excuse that they can. Oh, you have to have a viral load in the millions to even see a few. And we're going to have a sample of people with viral loads in the millions among those people who become customers of Viral Forensics. And people can order this service through my podcast by sending an email to howpositivearyou, the name of my podcast, howpositivearyou at viralforensics.com. And I'm sure we can include the link on
Absolutely.
The webpage for this. Yeah, I think that's historic. But I think it's also really telling that in, 35 years or something of having the scourge out there, and since 1984, okay, it's over 30 years, of believing that we're being under attack by a virus, nobody actually, put a commercially available analysis, not test, on the market to see if we all have it.
Well, let me ask you this. Is virus forensics finding a virus?
Yeah. That's what they intend to do. They put it under the you mean, do they ever find virus?
Right.
As far as I've heard, they don't. And there was another guy in Illinois doing an experiment, and he was trying to publish a paper, which somehow never got published, but he had... I mean, it's hardly a large sample, but there must have been about 14 people, a couple of them pretty well known, who supposedly died of AIDS or had AIDS, and he didn't find And he, you know, he was a pathologist. You know, he didn't find any HIV in their blood. And he had like all these ranges of viral load. Like viral load is the bogus figure.
So is viral forensics or virus forensics always going to find a negative
virus
finding?
Forensics.
Are they always going to find a...
Well, they're not committed to always finding a negative finding. Like, they're scientists and they want to explore, will we ever find this?
Oh.
So far, they have not. Okay? They're not in the business to, like, prove a point to say, well, we're just never going to find this. But the results so far are they haven't found any. You know, they haven't found anybody who actually has this virus in their blood. Now, you know, that's also secondary to the argument that's been going on for 30 years, advanced by Peter Duisberg and others, that even if you did have this virus, okay, if they found it in your blood, would it correlate and would it cause these diseases, this myriad list of diseases? You'd have to prove that people with it get these diseases and people without it don't get these diseases, which is not true. Like, people can get thrush and candida infections and, you know, viral things. You know, they can get pneumonia, they can get PCP pneumonia without ever testing positive. In fact, they had to deal with this problem in the early 90s by just changing the name. So when people show symptoms of AIDS, okay, which I think was at the time PCP pneumonia and Kaposi's sarcoma, which were the main things that started out being AIDS. You know, these really weird diseases that mostly gay men who partied a lot get. They had to call it something else. So they just started another name. And it was really absurd. It was very Alice in Wonderland. They called it idiopathic leukocytopenia or something. And leukocytopenia means that you have a low T cell count. Okay? Not a problem unless you're actually actively fighting an infection, I've heard. You know, like,
right.
You can have one, there was a joke told in the 90s, you know, I have one T cell left, but it's a damn good one. But, you know, there's no normal T cell levels. But you bet, if you're fighting a major infection, they should be through the roof. Like, you should be marshaling your forces. And the fact that you're not means there's something wrong with your immune system. But people were having this happen, and they didn't know why. So they named it idiopathic leukocytopenia. Idiopathic literally means unknown origin. We don't know what caused it. Because they didn't test positive on this test that we've had, so it's everybody else. It's really saying, we don't have a flipping clue. You know? We don't have a flipping clue what you have. Well, what you have is pneumonia. What you have is Kaposi's sarcoma caused by taking certain gay party drugs like poppers. Poppers, really just poppers. Which are, they enlarge the anus and provide a head rush during gay sex. I mean, I guess heterosexuals used to take it, but that thrill was gone. It's really the gay community that takes that.
Amazing.
Yeah. So really, you're not finding actual virus in these people. But also, you don't even have to prove that. We haven't had to prove that for 30 years. It's, you test positive, does it mean you're going to get sick? I don't know. You know, I could get sick and I never tested positive for anything.
Right. And the people that are dying of AIDS, or they're diagnosed,
what they're calling AIDS,
could be a myriad of other things.
Right. And there is a myth about, you know, it's a libel put online and in the news about people like me and people like Peter Duisberg. They like to like show us in our like most ridiculous poses and saying the most ridiculous things out of context. The myth is that we're in denial, that we're saying, you know what, you're not really sick. You know, get over it. But people are sick. Many of them are sick. I wouldn't say that all of them are sick. But many people are sick, and yes, they have things that need to be treated. And the tragedy here is that they're presenting themselves at hospital emergency rooms. They're getting looked up in a database, and they're being told, Well, mystery solved. The reason for your pneumonia is you have AIDS. So let's give you some AZT and a couple of other drugs and a cocktail, and we'll fix this up. And what's happening in some of these cases is that the Lazarus effect is real. People are actually leaving that emergency room, having their life saved by these drugs. Does that mean they should stay on these drugs? No, I don't think so. But they're put on them for the rest of their lives, which can damage their immune systems, basically, their digestive systems and their livers. But getting back to the Lazarus effect, aha, we gotcha. The drugs work. You know, my
right.
lover, my cousin, they were at death's door at the hospital, and now they're fine because they're taking this drug. And the thing is, we haven't really adequately investigated that, but the best that I've heard about that is that the drugs, toxic as they are really effective antifungals. That if you are really dying of fungal-related diseases, which is mostly what AIDS is in this country, fungal, candida-related diseases, that, you know, one mega dose of that stuff or over a week or 2 weeks, that's a very powerful antibiotic for fungus. And it may well have saved people's lives, yes.
And it's, did you say candida related?
Yeah, candida. I don't, let's call the whole thing off. Tomato, tomato.
Right.
Me.
That's a major epidemic. That's a major epidemic. That's a major epidemic, the candida. I've had that myself.
You have to.
Okay.
Could you repeat that?
Yes. Candida is a major epidemic. A lot of people relate it to cancer.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know causally. I mean, what I suspect, this is just my instinct after having run through this for 23 years, is that, you know, it isn't like candida causes cancer. It's that what I suspect is that the same kind of people who have candida problems also have a lot of acidity in their body, and they're likely to develop cancer. Also, the idea that cancer spreads from one place to another is complete baloney. If you have the kind of body that will develop lung cancer, it's also going to be the kind of body that develops brain cancer and pancreatic cancer and, you know, toe cancer. I don't know.
Right.
You know, like any kind of cancer. You're going to start getting it. So that's a big bombshell. We did a podcast with a chiropractor in California named Dr. Jeffrey McCombs, who was obviously selling something. It's a protocol to treat candida. And people are like, oh, snake oil salesman, quackery, blah, blah, blah. Well, not many doctors are really effectively treating candida. You know, you go there and they're like, well, it's all in your head, whatever. I mean, it's a lot of despair out there. And there's some alternative practitioners and chiropractors who are actually treating candida albicans, which is a fungal overgrowth in the body caused by too much alcohol, too much sugar, or any kind of imbalance. It could be caused by taking antibiotics long term, which, by the way, many of the gay men who originally presented with AIDS were on multi-year prescriptions for tetracycline and other antibiotics in the 70s. This was a time bomb waiting to go off. This was predictable that they would get fungal-related diseases, that they would present at hospitals in a different way than the rest of us. I mean, really under stress in their immune systems in a particular way. They were taking the same recreational drugs. They were hanging out at the same bathhouses. They're picking up the same infections. I mean, it was like, what infection didn't they have? I'm not talking about all gay men. I'm talking about a subset, okay, who are basically drug addicts, basically addicts. And so what we're seeing is that when people describe to us, say, look, I was fine for 10 years, but then I developed PCP pneumonia, or I have thrush, you know, I'll get on the phone with them, I'll say, hey, by the way, do you have thrush? Do you have yeast infections? Do you have digestive problems? And they'll always say yes. And they're like, oh, well, I was told that was AIDS.
Oh, boy.
AIDS today in the original population of gay men is Candida albicans. I mean, I don't know, you know, there are probably some cases that aren't, but that's all I'm seeing. That's all I'm hearing described. Now, okay, that's not what's happening to the Africans. I understand. Perfectly legit why they're getting sick the way they're getting sick, which is different. It's different things all over the world.
So in the Western population where we are, it could be Candida related. I know that there's a man...
Well, it could even be in that population. I should stand corrected. Because my partner David Crow in the podcast, he has made a lot of the research of what South Africans from the townships eat. And it's very heavy in like starches and cornmeal and tea and, you know, just things that are just loaded with fungus as well as sugar. Yeah, but I'm sorry, you were saying
no. They're gonna be drinking alcohol made from that same grain that they're eating. In the West here, there's a man named Tullius Simonetta. He's an Italian man, and he cures.
He's a what?
He's an Italian doctor, and he cures cancer by treating Candida.
Okay.
Of course, he's lost his license because he's curing cancer, because that's a big, you can't. We did a podcast.
No,
you can't do that because it's $500 billion. Every year, it's $500 billion. Cancer puts in the pharmaceuticals coffer. So you can't mess with cancer. Maybe AIDS, but not cancer.
No, you can't mess with AIDS either. Trust me.
Right.
There have been death threats made and death threats carried out around the world.
Wow.
There have been, yeah. But you were saying
now the AIDS
was that he was treating cancer by treating Candida albicans, and you know, I don't know the ins and outs of that. What I suspect is what I said before, that a body that is overrun with Candida albicans is obviously highly acidic, and it will be the ideal environment for developing cancer as well. So if you deal with that underlying condition, then chances are you're going to make some headway against cancer.
Absolutely. And you won't develop the myriad of symptoms that could be attributed to AIDS. Also.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the myriad of symptoms are Candida albicans in a lot of cases. You know, whatever else they're describing as AIDS is, things that I can get. It's, who hasn't had the flu at some point in their life? And flu is actually very poorly defined. You know, we thought we had the flu. It could have been an allergy. It could have been a chemical reaction. Who knows? But I've had the flu, okay, whatever they're calling the flu. But then they have this weasel word called flu-like symptoms.
Oh, yeah.
If you develop flu-like symptoms, you might have this mysterious ailment. You might have AIDS. You might, you know, it's just, or maybe you just have the flu, right?
Right.
And, you know, we interviewed a doctor in Europe who said that the statistics for that are doctored, that there aren't nearly... There are hardly any people dying of flu in Europe or in America or basically anywhere. You know, there are plenty of other reasons for people to die in
right.
some of these countries. Yeah.
But flu shots are a big money pot.
Oh, yeah.
So flu's not going to go
yeah,
away.
Flu shots are another example of something that has become, it's gone from science to religion. To oppose flu shots is to be some kind of a nut job. To oppose vaccinations for your children is some kind of a nut job. What I really want to stress for your listeners is that, you know, they might be tuning into this, oh, what a novel topic, this will never touch me. No, this touches you. The AIDS paradigm was developed many years before this vaccine brouhaha came up. The drugs that your grandmother is taking, those are fast track approved. Where did fast track approval come from? It came from ACT UP, demonstrating in front of pharmaceutical companies for faster approval of their products. I mean, how weird is that? It came, all the drugs that all of us take are now unsafe. The vaccines that we're being forced to take are based on a kind of religious view that sacrifices the individual to the herd. That's why they call it herd immunity. You know? And it's really a very pagan, very basic, primitive dynamic in a society that's under stress, that goes underground in civilized societies. It's right on the surface if you go to a tribe in Brazil or something. And it's about human sacrifice. And it's taboo to be the guy in the back of the room who says, "Hey, just a second, is this going to work or what? I don't get it. You mean you're going to sacrifice my kid and it's going to rain? I don't think so." Everybody has to be on board. There has to be unanimity. That's why there's such a stress on consensus. It's a ritual to bring us all together as a community instead of the spinning out of control way that we were in the 70s, if you can remember the 70s.
I can.
Yeah. I mean, they were fun. It was a fun decade.
It was.
But there was this sense in some quarters, and it had some reality to it, that people couldn't handle that freedom, that it was just like anything goes, the Bronx is burning. I mean, New York was literally burning down. We needed some cohesiveness in society, and I'm sorry, that doesn't look pretty in some... If you don't develop a consciousness in people that they can actually handle that freedom and be those people who are loving and who would not prey on their neighbors, that doing it without that, liberating society without that, just won't work. And I love your work on this. When I was watching your video on the California drought atrocity and the Julia Roberts commercials and things, I had ding, 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 I had a revelation, I had an epiphany that I called it conscience without consciousness.
Right.
That we're being corralled into these solutions. They're very collectivist and very sacrificing the individual needs to the collective, which, I'm somewhere along that spectrum. I'm not in the libertarian, don't sacrifice any of my fun for the collective a bit. It's not my right to drive a four-wheeler across a national park. It's we have taxes and we support public schools. I think that's a good thing. But everybody has their own place along that continuum. And, sacrificing the individual to the collective is noble. It's what keeps tribes alive. It's beautiful. It's described in the Bible. Okay?
Right.
It's described in Christianity, is what Christianity really is. The problem is that these are spiritual movements. They're not political ones. And when you're talking purely political, like imposing things on people who have not raised their consciousness, you're talking communism.
Exactly.
Communism ain't pretty. I'm sorry. So many friends are like, "No, but I'm Trotskyist, I'm great." No, it's all baloney. It's all terrible. And yeah, it's and I'm not just saying that because certain ancestors of mine or relatives were shot by the Bolsheviks in Russia. I don't have that story, that emotional thing in my family. We're all pretty okay, we're cool, we're in the present. But yeah, communism. That's what we're describing in these solutions. And I'm not the kind of person who just like sees a red scare around every tree. I've hung out with a lot of communists and socialists. I'm going to vote for Bernie Sanders, I'm totally, but there is a problem here. And the problem isn't collectivism. The problem is consciousness, that AIDS and these other explanations for things going on in the world are an expression of a very low vibration consciousness. So I hope that I haven't gone too woo-woo for everybody too fast, but really that's the connection.
No, not
between the politics and the consciousness. That if you're going to stay purely in a political realm trying to find solutions for things, all your solutions are going to just be worse than the problem.
Right.
Yeah, but the only way out at this point in humanity's history, and we are seeing it and we are getting it, it's amazing, is to awaken.
Right.
And that's what fascinated me about AIDS and continues to fascinate me, that it applies across the board to a lot of things. When I started getting, really getting, that this wasn't an us versus them, just evil pharmaceutical companies trying
Right.
to make money at our expense, that it really was something people sincerely, with all their heart believed in and had been taken in by, I started to see the mechanism by which it works, the pagan religious sacrifice that's being paraded before us as happy parades and liberation and tolerance and scientific progress. We're going to cure all the diseases. What is a cure anyway? It's God coming down on a cloud and saving you. You know, just like nothing to see here, nothing to resolve, no lifestyles to change, no awareness, no consciousness. We don't ascend to God. God comes down to us and fixes everything. And that's what pharmaceutical companies do. They have a new drug. Now you can take it. Now you've fixed it. Instead of dealing with underlying causes and the beauty of the ecosystem of this earth and of our bodies and of our consciousness. For us to realize that would be death to these paradigms.
Well, for the last 20 minutes, you defined exactly what we're up against. And you came about it through looking at AIDS and looking at the medical community. The medical community is probably the most blatant showing of this this conversion to a herd, this religion of compromise and religion of consensus, and how it's trapping us all. And you can see it in Technicolor with the AIDS hoax.
And especially like the medical community is a very good example. I'm glad you brought up. I'm going to take it in a slightly different interpretation there.
Go.
Instead of an us versus them, like how could these people be so evil?
Right.
You know, they're forced drugging children. They're testifying against their own patients in court. They're, you know, what happened to these people? But what happened to these people was they're really, really well-meaning people. They really do want to save humanity. They really do want to save their patients. Some people have reported to me that you can't tell me to leave my doctor. He's the person who's treated me with most respect in my life. And you're talking about people who don't come from very respected places. Even
right.
though they don't walk in to stores and get welcomed. They go to an AIDS clinic, though, and I was like, oh, a party breaks out. But So it really is a problem again of consciousness, you know. And it's all, and I don't exempt myself, and I don't exempt you. It's because the way that we talk about this as those evil people over there really bypasses the solution. And I'm really getting more and more of that in the last couple of years, and really examining myself and saying, oh well, you know. Yeah, and at the extreme radical end of this, I was just reviewing some videos about Ho'oponopono, the Hawaiian doctor who like has this cleansing thing where you take radical responsibility for everything you create. Is you created it,
right?
Because I think, and he talks about the data that we carry around, but this is not who we really are. If we were to just burn away all the data, We would just be pure. We would just be pure divine.
Right.
But we're a bundle of stories about how, you know, doctors did this to us. And,
right.
And the government does that. And this is communism versus fascism. And this is how my disease works. And we don't know jack shit. You know? We don't. You know, like,
that's perfect.
Yeah,
that's perfect.
Like we do, and we pretend like we're the righteous people and those people over there are bad. I don't know, you know, I'm not into the like there's no good and evil thing, but I think that evil is being so full of the database,
right,
as we say in Landmark, so full of shit, you know,
right
that you think shit is like real,
right
you think that that, you know, those people over there are part of some evil conspiracy. And I get asked a lot, you know, who are they? When I talk about they and they're trying to nail me on, oh, she's
right.
a conspiracy nut. I'm like the anti-conspiracy nut. I'm saying take responsibility for yourself and your own choices and your own life and your own consciousness, your own direct conduit to God. And get over these people out there. Do not mess with them. I would say do not. They are vicious when cornered. I've seen it. I've been there. Okay, because people think I have this lovely denialist life, you know, where I just go, oh, he's cool.
Right.
No. I've sat in courtrooms and I have watched a family get torn apart. I've had to testify to keep a nursing home from taking custody of a friend of mine who's only in his late 60s. I mean, I know about kickbacks and payments and extortion schemes. You know, I know about the careers that have been damaged. I've had people come to me and say, are you scared for your own life? Well, you know, I'm going to declare here, I guess, you know, it's de rigueur these days that you have to say that I'm not suicidal. I don't know what to think. I think that if I get murdered, that I created that, you know, that it's me dwelling on that. That if I just bring hope to people and information, they can do what they want with that information. And that's all I'm doing. The extra credit stuff, you know, if you need me to rescue you, I have to tell you, you got an awfully flimsy hope there. And a lot of people have expressed their disappointment with me for that. I just can't do it. And the whole point of my message is taking personal responsibility.
Exactly. How would they ask you to rescue them? I don't get that.
Well, usually, you know, it comes in the form of like a Facebook message, and, you know, somebody who says, well, you know, I was following your advice for 9 years and now look at me, I'm sick. Well, first of all, I don't give them advice, okay?
Right.
And second of all, I don't know this person's medical history. I don't know them for, you know, I talked to them on Facebook for 5 years. How do I know? Most of these people are lying that they're off the drugs. They go on, they go off. All I can say is if you really need that magic pill from me to believe my side, don't believe my side, okay? Because what we are about is no magic pills. It's not that simple as the story you've been told. There's no equally simple cult that you can join on the other side. It's the anti-cult.
It's the anti-cult.
Do your own research. You have to actually listen to my podcast. You know, the conversation with these people usually breaks down when I say, well, here's 5 podcasts to listen to. Call me next week. You know, and they're like, but I want an answer.
Right.
You can't just leave me there. Sorry, you know, but, and I have a really, unfortunately, cruel thing, message for people who buy into lies because they're not able to look into themselves, and I don't blame them. I think it's very hard to look
right.
into yourself and to get to a place where you can actually see what's in front of you, even 20% of it. You know, I'm still full of shit, and I probably see 10%, you know. You're going to be taken out of the gene pool. No? If your map doesn't match the territory, you're going to walk off a cliff. Just because you believe, say, that gravity doesn't exist, when you jump off the Brooklyn Bridge, you're going to smack into the East River anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, I don't have any way to sell my information, like, oh, you should do this. You know, you either like me or you don't like me, or you like my information, you don't like my information. I bring information to people.
Right.
And I probably engage with it way too much. But I just feel that's my life work.
Well,
to give people their power back.
That's exactly what we're trying to do. We always say, this is a quote, I'm trying to think of who it's from. Oh, it's an Ayn Rand quote. It says, you can ignore reality, but you can't ignore the consequences for ignoring reality.
Exactly. It's all your choice.
It's all your choice.
You know, even the friend of mine who ended up in a nursing home, you know, I asked him, well, when did you test positive? And he goes, 1991. So, but you were active in this cause since 1983. I said, why and where did you get your HIV test in 1991? Oh, it was the West Side Baths, and it was because if I didn't get the test, nobody would sleep with me. You know, you needed to get his clean bill.
Right.
So that's how I'm convinced more than half of the people who tested positive, tested believing that they, just, you know, get this checked off, get my clean bill of health for the year. And then suddenly it came back negative. I mean, came back positive for various reasons. There's like a long list, like 100 reasons why that could trip off, why anything could trip off a test, including a recent flu test, flu shot, or having children, you know, being pregnant a few times, having had malaria, having had antibodies to malaria because you grew up in a tropical country. So, and they're completely thrown off base by, oh my God, I tested positive.
Right.
And all years, and he was like, and I didn't believe in that kind of thing. And he didn't believe in it after he tested positive either. He continued to have sex with people, and he proudly says, you know, nobody ever came back to him saying he infected
right.
them. Well, you know, he had health problems later. He started falling, and he had to go to the hospital. And then he had to stay in the hospital longer for rehabilitation. The social worker in charge, I'm convinced, either he or she or the hospital received a kickback to put him in a certain nursing home
yep.
and tell him that Medicare would cover it 100%. He got taken off the rehab floor and put on the HIV floor, but the nursing home tried to take custody of him. I testified so that his brother, who disagrees with his health decisions anyway, could take custody of him. The last I checked, they revoked his privileges to go outside unless he took the drugs. I mean, all this chain reaction, you don't see that in happy parades and the stories about how much I was loved after I got HIV. I mean, this is really handing over your freedom. And people are like, well, all I did was make that one little mistake. That was a doozy, getting tested. Especially knowing that you didn't believe in that stuff. What am I supposed to do? How much more am I supposed to rescue this person? And I dearly love this person. You know? It's very hard.
Yeah, it's real easy to get trapped in that system. And, you know, I've had it happen to me, where I went to the hospital because of I was having these minor, like strokes. They were mini strokes. And I was confined in the hospital, wanted to go home. I was in California, couldn't leave. I had to stay there 3 days to wait to see an expert who told me exactly what they told me before. And, you know, it's a good thing I don't have any faith in the medical profession. So I didn't have the treatment, didn't have the tests, and no problems have occurred. But I think you're a great resource for someone investigating the medical community, especially the AIDS thing. I mean, if you know somebody that has AIDS, that's suffering with AIDS, they should certainly know you and know your podcast as a resource. Even if they don't believe you, you've got to do your own research. You have to look into this thing. That's part of the Great Awakening. We're here to awaken, and that's part of it.
What the mainstream has told people about people like me, we are the denialists, we are the AIDS dissidents, we're the bad people. They focus on what bad people we are, you know, and I don't know, maybe I'm a bad person in some ways, but I don't know, I think I'm pretty good, I think I'm pretty pure-hearted. They focus on, you know, don't listen to those crazy people, which is a way of bypassing any seriousness of our message.
Right.
That you can engage with my message and you can say, you know, I don't like that, or I don't like that, and she doesn't have proof of that. What is she talking about? But they base it on these people don't care about you. They don't care about the stigma, and they don't, you know, they're not part of your group. And okay, if you're the kind of person who is swayed by that argument, again, I have to say in all cruelty, you're going to be taken out of the gene pool. Like you say, the consequences of not grappling with the information that you're given in your life are huge. I've seen that in my own life. The only reason I am alive is because at several junctures in my life, I questioned received wisdom. You know, and it was hard. And sometimes I say to people who say, well, what's your secret for beating cancer? I say, you don't want to know. It's living 10 years in a complete personal hell of being different from other people and not being able to help them because they don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear.
Exactly.
Well, but because what I had to do was become different. It wasn't just, oh, I took this one supplement, I did Ravisi compounds, or it was the juicing and the, you know, the green juices and everything. Sure, but I, to begin with, I had to be the kind of person who questioned what was before me, even before I could get to those green juices or something. So it's a certain personality trait that
right.
is going to survive this, you know? And I sorry, I don't have any, you know, soft words. I have soft feelings, but I don't have any solution for people who want to bypass that. They have to take it on.
Right. I think a lot of us got into this because we're wired differently. The brainwashing didn't work the way it should have. So
yeah.
we ended up out here.
Now... You know,
right.
I know I was. You know, I have to share with you that, you know, I've been dealing with this a lot. You think you've dealt with it, but you haven't. My first day of first grade, the whole school ganged up on me. I mean, is that karma or what? You know, is that something you're just carrying around like a bad smell? I mean, I'm different. You know, I have to say that there are people in my life who love me. You know, I'm not like carrying around the resentment from there, but somewhere in my body it's been like carried around and triggered or something, you know, it's in your energy. But yeah, there we've all been traumatized in various ways, and those of us who are into this, I think, have been traumatized in a particular way, and we're still on it about it, you know, we're still like, well,
right.
Got it right, you know, but so it's its own kind of neurosis.
Well, yes.
I think that it proves helpful to some people. You know, they can discount part of it they don't like and just look at what's before them.
Exactly. I think that there's a lot of people from the normal gene pool that are now starting to wake up. And they're starting to wake up because of people like you. People that are standing up there and saying, no, wait a minute. Listen, wait a minute. Do your own research. Don't fall for that again. You know, you can save yourself if you do research or not. I think it's an important, that's an important message.
Yeah, well, I haven't even done that much research when you look at it. It's just so obvious, the logic, like if there's no real test, then what are we talking about? You know, like,
right.
What about my friend who died? And what about the babies? And what about the Africans? I don't know. You answer that question.
Right.
You know, like, because it's really, really simple logic. And it's so interesting to me. The simple logic is the one thing that can be right there in front of us.
Right.
And we just don't see it. If we're hypnotized by the culture that we're in. You know, and
exactly.
You've talked about television, you know, hypnotizing you, the, you know, the brain waves and the messages, and they stick little messages in there, and the Tavistock and the, you know, of all
right.
people, the hippies being taken over by that. But what is really encouraging to me is, well, for one thing, one particularly Christian podcast guest, a friend from Michigan, said, look, the Bible says we win. Okay. So the Bible, there's a vote.
Right.
You know, and consciousness is rising. Mm-hmm. It's so interesting. It really is. You know, the last people to have their consciousness raised, I think, are going to be the white liberals.
Maybe.
Just yeah, because they're already like, you know, on the winning team. They're already doing the right thing, helping the poor and everything. So they have nothing to see here. No self-deceptions. But it really is necessary. If you are listening to this and you are a white liberal, or you're a white liberal friend and you know who you are, please listen. There's more
please
out
listen.
There for you. There's more out there for you. There's and it's fun. Oh my God.
It's
you know,
fun.
I see some of my friends in this and I'm like, I'll have a good lady on the floor is having, please. You know, like they're hilarious and they're fun and it's what life is all about. Like they're really connecting to life. And I'm so happy that this journey has led me to such people.
Yes.
It's amazing. Don't, no matter how scary it is, make the leap, wake up.
Exactly.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let me move in a little bit different direction and I want your help going into this area. A lot of people are going to say, but my doctor says, but my doctor's advice is,
yeah.
And I think one of the things that I advise people to do, and I've done a lot of podcasts on this, is look into what that medical profession is, how it started, what it's based on. And I don't want to belittle the individual doctors. There's a lot of people that got into medicine not just to make a lot of money, but
yeah.
to actually help people. And
yeah.
some of them have gone into that profession, see that it's kind of tied really closely into the pharmaceutical industry. It was created by Rockefeller and the pharmaceutical industry. It was kind of like created as kind of a marketing arm.
Uh-huh.
And so what they'll see is that, like Simonetti, Tullius Simonetti, he saw that he was a... he was an oncologist, and he was burying his patients. And he decided to go out and try to find more cures, something that will actually cure them. And we've done podcasts on the myriad of health professionals that were, they were just wiped out in the United States, in Florida, because they had discovered a cure for cancer. Bad thing to do. But a lot of those people had been and were MDs. They had medical degrees, and they realized that sometimes, you know, it's not the most curing profession. And so I think rather than taking your doctor's advice for, like, he's a doctor, he's on a certain level, he's a scientist, or she's a scientist, and they know what they're talking about, go to the internet. Check it out. Find out what they're prescribing. Find out what the results are. There's so much information. And you can
yeah.
die because
you know, there's
of the
so
ignorance.
So much information that it confuses people.
Right, it
you
does.
And we're telling people, do your own research. Well, you know, I have a qualification to that.
Okay.
One is, I haven't researched everything either. So relax. It's basic logic. Okay. But also... instead of this history of medical profession, which is, you know, really interesting, and I think, you know, it might confirm for people. The thing is, we talk about a certain kind of person, the kind of person who wouldn't say what my doctor says.
Right.
Right? It's a kind of person who questions authority, not just for its own sake, to be, like, cool and radical or something, but to actually say, you know, truth comes from here.
Right.
It I know truth. I can find truth, and the trusting in experts, the trusting in doctors. I mean, Dr. Oz is great. You know, I love him. You know, he's on TV. He's great.
Right.
I know somebody who works for him, but there's only so much that Dr. Oz is going to say on TV, right?
Right.
And only so much that Dr. Oz even knows about. And what it is it's a wonderful thing because it meets people halfway, you know,
uh-huh.
where they get to still believe in some handsome expert.
Right.
The Morning America or wherever on with Scrubs. And, you know, he's like the new Marcus Welby. Huh? What do you think, doctor?
Right. Marcus Welby.
Marcus Welby is our model, is a certain
right.
generation's model, like our parents' model for what a doctor is. You know, you have 6 months to live. Okay. You know, you don't question that, right? So, you know, like a Dr. Oz, he's an authority figure.
Right.
And he's telling people, you know, do this to lose weight. And it makes a certain amount of sense, right? It's based on sound reasoning. After that, he's being, like, you know, completely clobbered. And, even that, like the expert with the wrong opinion, according to other experts, is
right.
being clobbered. why are you looking to experts anyway? You have the knowledge that you need. You are perfect. You know what to do. Yeah, so it's part of that religious paradigm, is that a religious paradigm has priests and
right.
priestesses. Okay? In our society that values science above all, like, as if we actually practice any science.
Right, exactly.
Just looking outdoors and seeing if it's cloudy or it's sunny, you know, we've got, you know, mathematical models and, you know, all kinds of things far removed from reality claiming to explain reality. We've put these people up on a pedestal. And I'm not sure that, you know, we should say that they have nothing to say. I know plenty of PhDs who do, and they're being run out of their fields. It's very, very dangerous when you elevate something like a dogma to a religion, a dogma about science, not science itself. And what's happening right now, that's, I think, part of what's causing us to wake up, it's so blatant and so violating of us, is the elevating of science to domination. So it's no longer, do you believe this or that or the other political ideology? That's not the struggle right now. The struggle right now is between versions of physical and spiritual reality. Whoever controls reality controls people. If you control the standards by which people practice medicine, called standards of care, and what insurance companies will and will not pay for, you control a lot. You control our idea of what our bodies are.
Exactly.
Now that's heavy domination. That's huge. And the struggle for liberation is not the struggle to be like, you know, less Republican or something. It's to become ownership of your own body, of your own destiny, and of your interpretation of the world around you without being called crazy. People are routinely given psychiatric evaluations because they refuse medicine for this non-existent disease.
Mm-hmm.
It's imposing a reality on us, and that is really, really scary. And I think it's gotten so scary that they're taking people's kids to enforce it. There's medical kidnappings, there's people being forced to vaccinate themselves and their kids, being forced to vaccinate themselves to keep their jobs. It's becoming too much. They went too far. Now all of a sudden people are going, I see. I see now. Yeah, sign me up. Whatever revolution you want. The problem, as Max Egan, I've listened to a little bit of his stuff, as he said, you know, what do you do once you have a revolution in the streets? Like, what's your solution?
Right.
Yeah, because the powers that be, the elites, and I do believe they exist. Hello, they do. They've got a solution. Yeah, one world government.
Yeah.
You know, one currency, all these trade agreements that are supposed to be about free trade. They're really controlling aspects of life worldwide, even controlling, like, patents on seeds and plants and things. One of the absurdities of our age, in my lifetime, my whole lifetime, is that one plant has become, one common plant that grows in North America has become illegal. Cannabis.
Right.
How nuts. What kind of, like, denial of nature do people have to be in to ban a plant that you can just grow in your backyard?
Right.
Oh, they might turn into drugs and get junior high schools, you know, stoned or something. I don't know. It's a plant.
It's a plant.
Plants can be used irresponsibly. I've often wondered, you know, there's like this psychedelic, entheogenic revival going on with people doing ayahuasca and things like that. I've often wondered, I don't know if you know the answer to this, like how many plants by the side of the road that we call weeds could be like brewed up in some sort of way or dried or turned into a tea, and they would have some kind of effect on us that we would wake up in some way. We would realize something. We would see reality. Because all plants have wisdom.
Exactly.
You're going to have to mow under like all the flora of the world to avoid that happening. It's just people don't have knowledge. But I was at Central Park at a picnic a year ago, and this guy had this wine. It was technically strawberry wine because that's what he used to ferment it. And I said, well, why is it giving me this weird kick? He said, well, it has Japanese knotweed in it.
Wow.
So where do you get, what is that? You know, well, it's actually an invasive weed from Japan or somewhere. It's really a problem in Great Britain. And he said Central Park in New York is overrun with it. And he just harvests it in like the early spring, and he makes a wine out of it. And that stuff is cool. It's
yeah.
great stuff. You know, and I'm just like, well, if they only knew at Central Park, you know, that this stuff is growing.
Well, what they do is they'd attack it with Roundup.
With what? With Roundup, right. Yeah,
right.
You know, we have these chemicals to protect us against, you know, the earth.
Reality, yeah.
Yeah, against reality.
We live in South America, and I was having nervous tension. Went to, I like a homeopathic doctor. There's tons of them here. Big cure that they have is called Dent de Lion, which translated means teeth of the lion, but what it is, it's dandelions. And dandelion, what's the worst thing in the United States to have in your lawn? Dandelions. They make tea out of the root and out of the leaves, and it has curative effects for probably 25 things. And this just got me back into myself. And it's a dandelion. I mean, that's,
yeah.
you know,
yeah,
grab some.
When I was a kid, you know.
Yeah.
We used to smear them on each other's cheeks and say, see, you like butter. I don't know what the right. joke was there, but it was how trailer park kids amused themselves, you know. And I don't know. Was I getting a little high from that?
Well, it didn't make me high. It made me better. Now,
better, yeah.
We can go back to cannabis, and there's a video called The Emperor of Hemp, The Emperor of Hemp. I don't know whether it's still on YouTube, but it was on 10 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And this person who was anti-cannabis, he's my age, so he was a Vietnam guy, came back from Vietnam, and he somehow got turned on to cannabis. And he found out that there's a type of cannabis that grows 20 feet tall in Southeast Asia. And it could be used, it could solve all the energy problems. And cannabis can be used this and that and another thing. Henry Ford made an entire car from cannabis. I don't think parts of the engine was made, but, and he powered it.
Yeah, you know, well,
he powered it with cannabis.
If the engine starts to burn, that could get kind of dicey.
Well, but he powered it. He powered it with cannabis.
Yeah, wow.
So when they were
in the
beginning of the 20th century, cannabis was going to compete with the newly emerging petroleum-based Dow chemical. And compete with a lot of the different products, including plastics. So what happened? There goes cannabis. And it's been illegal ever since. Now, it's the thing, I think, that's waking more people up than anything. I can remember, I don't know whether you know who Freeman Fly is. He's kind of fringy like we are, but he went around the country and to see where people were in terms of the awakening. And he found that most people that were waking up either used or had used cannabis. Now, it could be that they're more open-minded, so they're open-minded to this. There could be a lot of correlations, and
yeah.
I'm not...
It doesn't really connect for me. I was around cannabis all the time because my father owned a bar in the 70s, and so little interest in it. Maybe the few puffs I took made a difference.
No,
I don't know.
No, I think you were damaged from the beginning. I think you're like us. The brainwashing just did not work enough. Yeah, exactly, exactly. We also interview a guy from London who works with cannabis seeds, non-hallucinogenic seeds, when you take the when you cultivate a certain type that doesn't have THC in it, it has amazing curative.
Yeah, CBD oil.
Yeah, that's what it's called, CBD. Yeah.
There's not CBD. There's a myth that also that medical marijuana is this thing that you smoke, and I think that's what the medical marijuana clinics springing up across the country are doing.
Right.
I don't know that any of them dispense marijuana oil.
But no.
Marijuana oil, cannabis oil, is, as far as I can tell, a miracle substance. I mean, there's a Facebook group with, I don't know, 40,000 members or something, run by a cannabis oil consultant named John Marsh on the West Coast. And it's called Cannabis Oil Success Stories. And if you ever join it, you have to realize that there are 15,000 people on it at any given time. So if you post a comment on something or even post something, your phone is going to go ding, ding, ding. It's so many people sharing the benefits of this.
Yes.
It's unbelievable. It's like truth busting out all over.
We have
go ahead.
We have a friend, very close friend. And she's treated her cervical cancer with cannabis oil, and it's not there anymore.
Yeah.
Also, Rick Simmons. You've heard of Rick Simmons.
Rick Simpson. That's
Simpson, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Simpson.
Yeah, he's the subject of a documentary called Run from the Cure.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and there's some controversy over his recipe and the drugs, the chemical that he uses, or a solvent or something, But yeah, he should be given credit for bringing this up. And he's not exactly a stoner. Like, this is
no.
A retired farmer.
Yeah.
And every time I mention medical marijuana or cannabis oil, you know, it's like, I'll be even looking at somebody who was like a big stoner when I knew them, back in the day, and they'd be like,
yeah.
You know, they'll be like stifling a chuckle, like,
right.
That's so silly. You know, are we going to eat Pop-Tarts after we, you know, it's
right.
Just like, come on, like, get over it. It's just a plant, you know.
It's just a plant.
I experimented with it a bit. I have, I get really, like, easily overdosed on it, even though I'm not, smoking it doesn't do too
right.
much for me, but, you know, I'm like, can you hand that thing back? But the oil really packs the wallop, and I think I had a couple of bad trips on it that were not fun. And what I didn't like about it was that I would wake up the next day with a really bad headache, just a really out of sorts feeling,
yeah.
Like a secondary high that I just could not handle. And I understand why I think that Mr. Marsh is trying to create a chain of retreat centers. Because
uh-huh.
You really do, if you're going to really seriously go on this stuff, you need to be somewhere where somebody's taking care of you, somebody's babysitting you, you don't wander off, you don't go nuts, like, you know, paranoid or something. You know, what I had was not exactly paranoia, but it was like feeling like I was,
yeah.
You know, I was afraid to go outside the room, not because I was afraid there was something out there, but I just didn't want to go. There was something that kicked in that was really like in a cage of the present moment.
Right.
That can be bliss, but that can be a very bad trip too.
Right.
And, you know, I did it for some health problems, and I think it was beneficial in some way, but it just wasn't something that I wanted to keep doing.
Well, it's not for everybody, and some people get really paranoid with it. They use it, when we lived in Brazil, they use it in a ritualistic way, the same way they used ayahuasca. So, but, you know, I'm kind of backing.
These things are meant to be in rituals, too. They're not meant to be like a party drug. Right.
Right?
So that's why I think I've always just on some visceral level, like even when I was a teenager or in college, like didn't think it was a good idea to smoke marijuana at a party. It seemed to kill a party. It really did. Like alcohol got
right.
The party. The anti-drug was marijuana.
Right,
you know?
Right, right, right.
So like, it's been just miscast. Yeah, I will say, but you made an interesting point about, you know, people who have woken up being marijuana users. And of course, there's that confounding factor of, you know, you have to be kind of woken up to try it in the first place, or at least a rebellious 12-year-old.
Right.
But I do think it's true. It varies by the person, I would think.
Sure, sure.
But and I always thought it was some kind of a joke, like, you know, every true stoner you've ever known is like, oh, dude, we're going to change the world.
Right.
And you see this guy, and he can't even get up off the couch.
Right,
right.
Right.
It's like, where's my Pop-Tarts, you know?
Right.
So I always thought that was a joke, but then I started really reading about it on the internet. There's actually a professor at the University of Colorado who's been following this and saying that, you know, the real reason that we don't have legalized marijuana is it's just, like, you know, mind-blowing. People stop behaving. They stop
right.
Respecting experts on things. They start thinking for themselves. Well, great. I mean, let's do more plants, you know? Let's just do that.
That's right.
But, you know, and that to me constitutes consciousness.
Right.
And not just, and I think that's what got derailed in the 60s. I mean, you know more about this than I do. I mean,
I'm older.
As a kid, because I was near Ann Arbor, Michigan. But, yeah, oh, you're from Boulder. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, I mean, I think that there was something derailed in the hippie movement. And you've mentioned Tavistock. And how so many people could be doing marijuana daily, and yet, I don't know, woke up in quite the wrong way. It kind of gets back to the idea of conscience without consciousness.
That's
that
good.
They were put back into kind of a political box of being sort of left wing.
Right.
Instead of being truly revolutionary as they could have been. And I don't think that the time was right. I think, you know, being sort of new agey woo-woo myself, I think that it was the dawning of the age of Aquarius, right?
Right.
It was the dawning of a new generation. And now, you know, we're all elderly. We're all like, you know, like, what happened, right? But, and I'm sort of Generation X, so I'm not quite elderly, but... You know, if we're middle-aged or elderly, we're comparing the two eras, and we're going, something's going on here, but I hope it doesn't turn out to be the bad trip it was last time.
Well, what, having done a lot of research on this, the human beings live in a, one way to look at it is in a saeculum. A saeculum is a measure of a lifetime. It's about 84 to 100 years. And during the cycle, saeculum, it goes through cycles. It goes from a high to an awakening, to a degeneration, and then to a crisis.
Unraveling,
they call it unraveling. I've got my coach here.
Yeah.
So I was born during a high period. That makes me a baby boomer. It also makes me a prophet generation, because that...
Prophet with a PH.
With a prophet.
No,
that's right. Prophet with a PH.
Generation in the 80s. That didn't work out too well either.
So we come in during a high, and we take part in this awakening. Well, for the last two awakenings before this, it was all about rights, mostly women's rights, and anti-war. This one was about rights and anti-war. And it wasn't just us. It was our parents. It was the labor unions. We were all there. But Tavistock saw it coming, because Tavistock's aware of this. So Tavistock puts in to us kind of a little distraction. First of all, he wanted to find out how they could derail us with LSD. So they showered us with LSD. They gave us the peace symbol, which is the upside down converted cross. It means the defeat of Jesus Christ. And they gave us all of these things. We got into sex, drugs, and rock and roll. So we got kind of thrown off these civil rights and the anti-war. Well, they stopped Vietnam. So we stopped complaining about the war. And since we're into sex, drugs...
You stopped it after 10 years or something. I mean, that's hardly a victory, but...
That's hardly a victory, actually.
Thanks.
And the civil rights, we got them to pass a law, but the worst thing you can do for civil rights is pass a law. It makes people resent you. I mean, it's like the worst ending. So Tavistock was able to derail all of our good intention, And now we're thrust into this thing that they call a crisis. The last crisis was World War II. There's clear winners, clear losers. And here we are. We have to realize that we're up against not Muslims. We're not up against the liberals. We're not up against the conservative white guys. We're up against a control system that's been on our back for millennia. And if we can just stand up, see them there, and not turn off the TV. When you go to your doctor, come home and research what he's given you, or she's given you. We don't have a doctor. But we're in a different kind of a thing now, and we're trying to, through efforts of people like you, find out truth.
Yeah.
And that's all we're trying to do.
Yeah, we are. We're trying to just get to that zero place where we know ourselves.
Exactly.
Part of what they, or they are, and maybe we are doing to ourselves is what you say, building these dramas and these crises and these, and you know, there's a whole movement on Facebook and everywhere, you know, false flag events. That shooting didn't really happen. I don't know. All I know is it doesn't take much to get Americans, you know, in a two-sided war against each other.
Right.
You start with abortion. You know, most Americans actually are for legal abortion, but they do consider it a moral issue.
Right, I think
so
they do.
So they polarize the sides. You know, for me, a moral issue means the government stays the hell out of there.
Me too.
Yeah, exactly.
Me too.
It doesn't make me less moral to be for, you know, legal abortion. But they polarized both sides of, I went to an event when I was in grad school where we saw a film, and it was good, but there were some disturbing comments like, oh, abortion's no big deal, it's just a medical procedure, why are they making a big deal out of this, you know, they have an agenda. Well, I know they have an agenda, I got that part, but I raised my hand. I'm like, hey, you know, can I still consider it a moral issue? I mean, isn't that why I'm a pro-choice? And they were like, shut this woman down.
And whoa.
What are you talking about? And I realized I was surrounded by lesbians who were never going to get pregnant. You know, I was 27 years old, and I had a real concern there, you know. But it doesn't get much more polarized than the lesbians versus the Jerry Falwells, you know, and the things that we're told right now, you know, the Muslims versus us. Who created that Muslim extremism?
Exactly.
The CIA.
Exactly.
Finance groups.
It was all oil money. Oil money coming from Saudi Arabia, going back to Saudi Arabia and Pakistan, creating radicals.
They can touch the conflict button in us. So when I was a journalism student, number one news value is conflict. People fighting at a city council meeting, that's your headline, you know? So I could think of a million things. I think I even took some notes on some. You know, there's meaningless debates. Just meaningless. We're all human. We all want the same thing. Come on. And, like, in AIDS, there is there's this little red herring thrown in there, which is manufactured HIV. You talk to most of the minority population in the subways of major cities and say, hey, you know, this AIDS thing is all a bunch of baloney. And they go, oh, yeah, it was manufactured in a lab and dropped on people in Africa. And then they put it in vaccines. And, you know, they get really excited. And I think it was Jeremiah Wright, who was Obama's friend in Chicago, got dropped really quick when he started talking the truth, basically. He said, you know, I wouldn't put it past my government to do that. I believe my government would do that.
Yes.
He didn't say the government did that. He said, I wouldn't put it past them. I wouldn't put it past them either. But the thing is, they haven't succeeded. Okay?
Right.
Because we're not finding this so-called virus that they're saying, this is a virus. We're not finding it on the electron microscopy screens. So it's kind of this meme that's been dropped into minority communities to make them think like, I have the truth. I know what's going on. You can't fool me. But, you know, in the meantime, nobody questions getting tested because that's how you fight it. And nobody questions how getting treated, because that's you're taking your power back. And it just feeds right into the system. There is no virus. It's a false debate. It's a false debate. It's
that's great. That's great.
Yeah. And just this morning, I woke up to an NPR report. There's a so-called debate among scientists over lab research on dangerous mutated viruses. Because and here's another question: like, why are they doing research trying to mutate viruses in a lab at Harvard or somewhere? Like, I don't get it. Like, why would you do that? Except to find the one that you might drop on, ISIS or somebody,
right,
or the next boogeyman out there and cause widespread disease. Like, it's obviously defense research, but my question was, well, what I know about that is that mutated viruses are dead viruses. As Dr. David Rasnick asked me like 20 years ago, it was like, if HIV mutates as fast as it does, okay, that's why they have to keep developing new drugs.
Right.
If it mutates that fast, how the heck is it going to get into the substrate of the cell? It's supposed to take over, mimic your own DNA in part and like reproduce itself. Well, if that code is off by one digit, you can't open the safe. So it's just a piece of debris in your body. So if they're working on these mutated viruses and they're, putting them into vaccines and dropping around people in the jungle, well, that's your tax dollars at work doing nothing.
Right.
But they're like, oh, is this safe research? Those monster viruses might get out. What's the risk? What's the benefit? And it sounds like there's a real debate going on, but nobody's doing any like really valid research there. It all sounds really science fiction-y to me.
Well, there's a video out I've seen. I actually haven't seen the video, but it says, this man created the AIDS virus. And so they're offering that side of the that false story, I guess. If there's no AIDS.
I don't know whether some man created a false virus or not. To me, it's irrelevant. They're not finding it taking over the body of anybody who's died of AIDS. They can make whatever they want. What these things do is they get people asking the wrong questions.
Yeah.
African Americans asking, why are they doing this to us? Instead of should we even get that test, because what will it do to our lives? And that they don't ask that the tests, they don't ask about the tests being biased to find this thing in African and tropical populations. I mean, it does in greater numbers than other populations. Doesn't mean they're sicker. They just have these particular antibodies in bigger concentrations. And, the ultimate wrong question about AIDS is, when will we get a better drug? Do you need these drugs in the first place? Maybe you just need treatment for your candida. Maybe you need to get into treatment for alcohol and drug abuse. Maybe there is a paradigm in this country that treats certain groups like patsies, and you need to stand up for yourself. I mean, truly stand up for yourself, not this fake, oh, I'm so proud
right.
and gay kind of, it's really standing up to be as a white person is. As a white person, I'm not asked to, at least not by other than extremist groups, I'm not asked to stand up for the rights of white people. And this is what white people are, and you need to be that, right?
Right.
You need to dress like this, and you listen to music. But these groups are. And why don't they have the same right as I do to just being themselves? And for saying that, it's like I'm on some kind of racist riff or something. But they claim that the AIDS establishment claims ownership of what racist means, when they themselves are very, very racist. They made up a story about how white people catch a disease sexually from black people, because the black people were so stupid, they were having sex with monkeys. No, dead monkeys. No, dead monkeys that had been sitting around in their mud hut for a month. I mean, when do we start to look? Dave Chappelle actually did a comedy routine on that.
I'd love to hear it.
Some of them are actually waking up, you know, over there. They're not, like, you know, towing the line at all. You know, the black entertainers are the biggest, you know, loose cannon ready to go off. They're not buying this anymore. They're waking up over there as well in these minority communities. And, you know, the biggest lie of our era is, hi, I'm a white person and I'm here to help you.
Yeah.
They think, oh, this one's different. This one, they're actually going to save us from this epidemic. It isn't like Tuskegee. No, and we'll bring up Tuskegee every time. It's oh, no, we get free benefits to go and we get free testing. Wow. I mean, aren't we the special group of people? Yeah, when you start being treated like the special group of people in this country, you need to get the hell out of here.
Right.
Right, yeah. You know, just don't. Do not, you know, they're always treating you like the special person at the doctor's office, and they have a special test for the disease you got. You need to start questioning why they think you have a disease. Because as far as I'm concerned, as far as I've read in history, white people have spread more diseases to other people than vice versa. But it's a racism itself, if you get to its primitive roots, is a fear of the other tribe, right? So they may be people, but they're black. They may be white people, but they're Jewish. There's some critical difference, and you don't want to be contaminated by that.
Yeah, that's
the fear of contamination. And where does contamination happen? Through sex, through blood?
Right.
It's just that whole story just dredged up again, and they tell it, and they slap an anti-racist label on it and say, if you don't believe this, you're racist. Makes no sense.
Well, we're going to be called, I'm going to be called racist all the time.
Yeah, well, you know, certain people own that franchise.
Yeah, they do.
So, yeah. Those of us outside it need not apply, but you know, I don't care, you know, if there's a black thing and a white thing and a, you know, a Bulgarian-American thing, I'm Bulgarian-American. You know, that's just a parlor game for me. I get to make certain foods and I get to, you know, hang out and talk about how maybe I'm different from other groups. But in the end, we're all just people. And if we really believe in that inclusive thing, then we all have a right to self-determination and making up our mind for ourselves, not following the herd. Have you ever read a book called The Culture of Narcissism by Christopher Lash?
No, it sounds great, though.
Yeah, very timely, published in 1979, I believe. And he basically says that narcissism is not loving yourself. You cannot love yourself enough, okay? To love yourself is great. Narcissism is self-hate, and it's loving an identity that you've taken on to cover that up. So if you take on an identity of the herd, you start acting like the herd, and considering that your identity, you're hollow at your core, and you can be sold all kinds of products because they fit with shoring up that identity. So that's what happened in the game in the late 70s, early 80s. It was an identity. You know, they came to the cities. They were liberated for 10 years. They finally came to the cities, young men, finding their place in the world, the people they wanted to hang out with, the culture that they could deal with. But that was it. Like, there was no real self-development for a lot of them. Now, I'm not saying everybody, but that was the culture that was encouraged and reported on by the media. It's really not a story for gay men to come to the city and live like everybody else. Like, that doesn't really make a good 2020 episode, you know? So you look for the weirdos, you know? You look for the guys living in a house with each other. There was a great film made in the early 90s called Paris is Burning, a documentary about these guys. And they lived in houses in Greenwich Village together, and they were families. They were literally families, and they truly loved each other. And they competed against other families in these sort of drag fashion show things. And they would talk trash about the other houses, you know,
right.
It was part of it. But in the end, like, several of them died. They were doing dangerous things. They didn't really have a true self. They didn't graduate from the first two chakras, which are the first chakra, the root chakra, is your tribe. The second chakra is sexual, financial, relationships, The third chakra is self-individuation, like identity, self-actualization. To get there, you have to be willing to like leave your tribe and do something different.
Right.
And that's what you weren't prepared to do.
Well, there was a stigma, you know, back then. There was more of a stigma against gay people. I can remember in my parents' generation, they had to kind of leave. They like your gay uncle lived somewhere far away, and so they had that. Also, I'm getting to realize that you may agree or disagree with this, but I think sodomy, especially sodomy done at a young age, has a tendency to lock you into the lower chakras. I know.
I've heard that in a slightly different form. And I can't comment on whether it's accurate or not. It does sound accurate. What I'd like to caution about is taking it as an all-encompassing theory of why people are gay, that happened to all of them. You know,
I'm not saying that's why they're gay. I'm saying that behavior, especially at a very young age, limits your ability to expand consciousness. Aleister Crowley would say that the modern day Satanists that are doing that, they try to make sure the child is sodomized before. I know this is a disgusting subject, but it's part of our reality.
Brought up, but I think that there are forces among gay people that are suppressing that information. You know, they don't want to even consider that half of things, the dark side of why some people are gay. And as I said, you know, like there's plenty of very well-adjusted gay citizens in our society, and they don't do these things that lead to so-called AIDS. What you were saying brought up something that I completely forgot, but that's okay. That's how these conversations go. But it's the...
If you can find it, it would be good.
Yeah, well, there are some interesting websites. Usually they have kind of a bigoted point of view, but I do read some of them to just, you know, to see is there anything that can be plucked from there. And sometimes I do find things. Yeah. So, the sodomy thing. Yeah. Okay. Why are people and your parents and, you know, the warning you against that uncle, why are people so homophobic? Why? Why does it matter? Now, when I was in junior high school in the 70s, it was a big joke, you know, if you faggot. Or, One classmate of mine just, like, slugged me when I was caught, like, staring at a classmate's boobs. I don't know if I was staring at the boobs or the pictures on her sweater or what, you know, like I do stare at women's bodies. I think they're beautiful.
Me too.
I had a great job in college accompanying ballet classes, and that was a visual feast. You know,
oh,
I love
wow.
that. I don't consider myself gay. It was a good way to get killed. But we had a librarian who was so openly gay. I mean, just in the way that he dressed, the way he acted, the way that he talked. And not one parent went to the school district and said, I don't want this with my kids. We all loved the guy, you know? And it was a small town in Michigan. It was like, oh, you know, the proverbial, you know, book burning, Shirley Jackson story, you know? So I've always wondered, like, why would anybody care enough to get really upset about that, you know? And it goes back to distinctions in society that are very, very important in this primitive religion that is the common denominator of unconscious humanity. Unless we've graduated to a higher level of consciousness, this is how we keep our societies from killing each other.
Right.
We keep conflict to a minimum. And the way to keep conflict to a minimum is to warn against any digression against the rules, the distinctions. Male is male, female is female.
Right.
Okay? You don't mess with that. You mess with that, it starts to mess with people's everything.
Right.
Gets fluid. And in America, we think that we're evolved enough to like finally let all this stuff out of the closet. And we are. I mean, it's amazing that we are. But there's still a part of us that's really traumatized by it. And so, you know, I know the right answer to whether I support discrimination against gays or or blacks or, you know, whatever group you're talking
right.
about. I know the right answer. You know, I'm all inclusive. I'm good. You know, I'm a good person. I'm a good American. I'm modern. But if I ignore that other reality about what racism really is, that it's a fear of contamination, that my brothers and sisters on this planet may be, for reasons not their own, filled with data, with reflexes in them that make it so that they can't deal with that, that they run back to that primitive way of protecting society. I've become less judgmental of that. I've become more loving and more suggesting, more able to suggest that everybody just try to raise your consciousness a little bit. It doesn't, you know, you have to approach it sincerely. You can't be dragged into being anti-racist if you're a racist. We don't all just get educated. We don't all just hold hands or go to each other's parties. You have to really be sincere in that, and that comes from a very deep place inside. I can't engineer that from where I sit. I don't like it, but the solution, if we're going to keep on sitting around talking about how we as really liberal people need to educate other people to our point of view. Well, I've got a laundry list of like many things I want to
right.
educate people to, right? And they got a laundry list they want to educate me to. So far, we're at a stalemate. Something's got to give. And I think that what the work that you're doing really stresses consciousness and awakening and in a very ground level way. Like, you're not just out there woo woo, like, you know, the world will be saved when we all get woo groups and
thanks.
And, you know, and stop worshiping Jesus and start worshiping Ram Dass or something. You know, it's, yeah.
Right. Well,
yeah. Thank you for the work you do.
Well, thank you for coming on, and thank you for the work you do. I really do want to say that, you know, I am myself not, I don't discriminate against these different lifestyle claims. I mean, I certainly want to stop pedophilia or bestiality.
Yeah. I mean, we all draw a line somewhere.
Yeah, we draw the line somewhere. But, you know, and it's just been recently with this idea of sodomy and how the dark side uses it that makes me want to caution people about that. Now,
yeah.
if I like men or like women, it doesn't matter. But there's a certain behavior that maybe you should research.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying.
I don't know. For all I know, I don't know which direction it will go when we all become really high
exactly.
consciousness. Will we become more heterosexual, or will we become more heteroflexible?
You You're know, right.
I don't know what direction that's going to go. I think that it will be genuine. It will be authentic.
It'll
and
be.
That's what we're reaching for, authenticity.
Exactly.
In this life. I mean, otherwise, what's the point? You know, you can get better outfits. You can, you know, hang out on better beaches.
You can have better conversations.
You can have
that's
better
the beauty.
Yeah.
That's the beauty. I can get to know you. You can get to know me. Exactly.
You can just feel people with your heart. You can just have more
exactly.
love. You can and less fear. Like, you know, we've got this armor. Like, if we love, somebody will smack us.
Right.
And that's the fear that we have to let go. You know, like nothing's worse than where the stalemate that the world is in as we speak right now. It's becoming actually pretty frightening. Even the people who don't watch TV, who turn off that stuff. All I can say is that love is here for you.
Exactly.
I can't say you're bad doing that. I can just say love is here for you. Why don't you just join the party?
Join the
you
party.
You don't have to make up diseases to be loved. No?
That's right.
Like, you got enough diseases to deal with already. And a disease, think of it, an illness, at least in my life, has been a gift. It wakes me up. If you were waiting for that moment when you wake up, like you want to fly to Peru and do an ayahuasca trip, cool. But isn't it right in front of you? Your relationships with your family, your relationships with your spouse, with your children. Is that challenging enough for you to like wake up into love? I mean.
Pay attention.
Yeah, it's pay attention.
Pay attention.
And
it's coming all the time.
That backache that you're complaining about and you want to get surgery for and blah, 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 and you're complaining about it and you're boring your relatives with it. It's something lodged in there. It's
right.
A suppressed feeling. It's an invitation to get up and like fish around for what that might be. And when you start along that path, I'm telling you, it's just as scary as you thought. You will become a real weird person exploring
right.
stuff. You really will. You know, it's just it's given and it's great.
And it's great. It's a beautiful way to be. Hey, this has been a wonderful interview. It's far, far exceeded my expectations, and it's so wonderful to have you on World Beyond Belief with us. Thank you very much, Beth.
Thank you, and please listen to my podcast. I'll post a cross-link to it there. It's called howpositivearyou.com.
Okay, can they get in touch with you through that podcast?
Yes.
Or?
Yeah. There's a contact us page, and they can also on that page find the email for viral forensics and getting their blood actually gosh darn tested.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you very much, Beth. Hope that we can stay in contact and maybe have you back on World Beyond Belief.
Would love it. Thanks.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.